Good.
But in my case, when you flip for 14 hours, you're like, what? Yeah, it's a thing. What do you do?
True. All right, so Anita will be along here shortly. We just finished up supper, so. There we go. I know last time we everybody made up characters and everything. Does anybody have any questions? I disseminated the rumors you guys made up, so everybody has heard something about some of the other people. And I think I moved your more used things onto the taskbar for any of you if you're so inclined to do things that way. As a quick tip that we discovered and then forgot about and then rediscovered, if you're not typing anything in chat or anything and you hit C, it will actually bring up your character sheet.
Ooh. I used it so much last night.
So yeah, it comes in super handy.
Just like minimizing the sheet by double clicking by your name.
Yeah.
You also drag and drop your spells directly to your macros.
Yep. Yeah, your spells and your equipment, you can drop right onto your thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was a good to hit roll anyway.
Hey, at least I did something, right?
That's right. You know, damage on target is still damage on target.
Hey Anita, how have you been? I haven't seen you in so long.
I know, right? It's been ages.
For anybody watching the stream, they played like Star Trek Adventures just ending a couple hours ago.
2 hours ago, yeah.
That's a couple.
Yeah, it's a couple.
I mean, and before that, there was Alien last night as well.
Yes. Boy.
It's been a gaming weekend.
It is. I love it.
Hey, folks, a gaming weekend? I'm just saying.
I need to send you my image for a token.
Okay. It will probably not be ready for today's session.
That's okay. So.
All right. So, as we get into things, the world of Thylea has, for the last 500 years, been relatively peaceful. There was an oath of peace sworn between the Titans and the five gods that would stop the Titans from destroying things and stop the gods from fighting the Titans and so on and so forth. So for 500 years, it has been relatively peaceful, but now the word is circulating because the 500 years of the Oath of Peace is coming to an end. The future is looking grim. There are monsters menacing the roads. There's corruption in the cities. The Titan of Storms, the Storm God Sidon, demands daily sacrifices at every one of his temples. His sister slash wife Lutheria, her cultists are out and about kidnapping children for dark rituals.
It's kind of like modern times.
It's like modern times. The five gods who used to protect the settler races, the humans, the elves, the dwarves, and so on and so forth, are silent. And the oracle has prophesied that the doom of Thylea is here. The death of the gods, the destruction of Mitros, which is the major city, and the total annihilation of all of the mortal races.
These gods probably should have just done what the real gods, the real Greek gods did and killed the Titans outright.
Yes.
If that, I have a bridge I can sell you.
Well, no pressure is what you're saying.
No pressure. But word has gone out, and now warriors from across the lands are being summoned to an area called the Heartlands. in an attempt to avert the upcoming tragedy. So you'll see the Heartlands there on the map as soon as I activate it.
Go, go, Gadget Maps.
Go, go, Gadget Maps.
Praise be to Lugal, God of Maps.
But for now, you are on the road to a tavern. A bard who's basically been working as the voice of the Oracle, named Kyra, has been traveling around, sending out word for heroes, those who think they might be worthy, those with something to prove, those who, you know, just want to get out and see the world. Basically, the call has gone far and wide for heroes to meet at a taverna, a country inn called the Sour Vintage, which is just to the east of the city of Astoria. So you'll see Astoria there on the map. I do have a little party token so you guys can map where you are on the map, but it's hard to see. So I will have to do something. But just so you guys can get a feel for how things work with Foundry, how things work with 5E, and before your before it's a matter of you know, the life, the universe, and everything. We'll say it's not uncommon for strangers to band together on the road while they're traveling. Not only are there rumors and stories of monsters on the roads, but also bandits. Some people are getting pretty desperate. The most of you can't remember the last time there was a significant rainfall. You know, spatterings here and there. But there's thoughts that unless the daily sacrifices decide on continue, the Lord of Storms, the God of Storms, is displeased and thus is withholding the rain.
What a meanie.
So as a result, cattle is hard to find, sheep are hard to find, like any sort of animal that would be deemed a worthy sacrifice. Essentially, farmers are getting paid better to have their animals slaughtered for Sidon than to feed people.
Yeah, but can't you do double duty with that? I mean, after you've sacrificed the creature, I mean, you can then cut it up into chops, right?
Nah, man, gods demand the full sacrifice.
Yeah,
you gotta burn it on the pyre.
Do they actually come down and eat it, or just like magically disappear?
No, you burn it on the pyre, so symbolically they devour it.
Depends on whether or not you consider fire magic, I guess.
No, everything doesn't need to be burned. I mean, that is how we cook things.
I imagine it would also depend on the god and their rituals. Like, a storm god, maybe you have to dump it in the ocean. I don't know.
Ooh, yeah, I could probably see that. That would be bad.
So the five of you, have kind of been traveling in the same general direction for a little while. So you've kind of, you know, not necessarily out of fear per se, but it's been a little bit of a hike. It's nice to have somebody to travel with. So the five of you have grouped together. We won't say banded together or anything, but have grouped together along the road to the Sour Vintage Inn. The weather outside, it's like kind of late mid spring, so the temperature is warm. There's a nice breeze blowing, but it is, you can tell, like there's a certain dryness to the grass and to the dust on the road. Like, what little rain Lord Sidon does allow is not enough to satiate anything.
Well, as an armored character, I definitely appreciate the lack of humidity.
But feel free to describe yourselves to one another. What do people see when they notice you?
So Helena is a short female with long dark hair and big female black with wings. Long
dark hair.
Otherwise relatively human looking.
Sophia is Sophia is about 7 feet tall. She's a minotaur. She is dressed entirely in white. Like a white robe that's clasped on one shoulder, white cloak. She has a golden circlet that rests between her horns and her ears. Her horns are only about 6 inches long. Not terribly long, but you still wouldn't want to get impaled by one. She carries a small rucksack and a holy symbol. But she's entirely white. And she's more like a Highland... If you've ever seen Highland cattle, the way they kind of comes down over their eyes.
Yes.
She has that going on.
Cool. That's probably offensive.
Oh, on some level, I'm sure it is. Deacon. Stop that. Discord playing games with me again. Deacon is basically about 5'10". And he's got that nice kind of, you know, Mediterranean olive complexion. Wears basically chainmail and other little bits and pieces that would identify him easily as a hoplite, with a fairly large shield, spear. Also seems to have a small sword and a large sword strapped on his body. Currently, though, walking without helmet, because he just carries it with him because he'd rather have the wind blow through his hair at this point in time. Hair is long and black.
Erethius is a slender, quite strikingly handsome human-appearing man. He's wearing his leather armor, but it's well-kept and... it's actually decorated slightly for appearance, as well as the cloak that he tends to wear seems to be almost more style than function. That said, however, he has a very serious gaze about him as he scans the lands while the group travels, and at night he watches the stars, but with his hood actually over his head.
All right, let's try this again.
And Agri is about a 6 foot, 7 foot-ish centaur. he dons a scimitar at his side, however you've hardly ever seen him use it, as he's more in tune with nature, it seems, than anything else.
And you guys have been traveling together for like just a couple of days. It's...
Oh, is that the party marker on the river there?
It is. I'm going to see if I can, like, darken it around a little bit. But yeah, it's basically it's just a stylized dragon compass with compass rose with a dragon head on it. It seemed fitting. So you guys have been traveling for, you know, a couple of days, getting to know one another. Various other people have kind of joined you for a part of your hike and then left along the way. And you come to a place where the road winds out ever so slightly. And we'll say Agri and Sophia are in front, and you see a couple of what are very, very obvious ne'er-do-wells. It's not often you see folks on the road brandishing weapons. You know, as they see you kind of coming up, they're two of them on the road, and they've actually already got their weapons out. Like, they have ill intent upon their mind.
Ooh, highwaymen.
Another note to point out is Helena is always humming something. You might not recognize what she's singing, but she's always humming something.
And as they see you approach, they've got their short swords out, like, halt there, travelers. We regret to inform you that there is a toll upon this road. Times are tough, and we have. He looks at the other guy. They look back now. Children to feed. Yeah, children to feed.
Well, yeah, that sounds convincing.
No, it doesn't.
Gentlemen, I'm sure that you understand that this road does often have a toll upon it. Those that travel upon it and those that linger sometimes pay a cost too great for them. Perhaps wisdom would be the better course here, and you move along and let us continue on our road, so you may continue on yours.
Well, good folk, how much is your toll?
Casting guidance on B's character.
Okay. So, as you step forward, they're like, they kind of look at one another. They're like, how much? Ten drachma.
Wonderful. And whose coffers will we be filling with this tax?
They kind of look at one another again.
No one's, Deacon. They stopped us in error. They know that it is wiser for them to move on than to take our poor, meager offerings. There'll be richer horses to come.
You can see two.
Yeah, fellas, this is definitely a mistake. You should probably move along. Listen to my friend here. He usually knows what he's talking about.
Alright, I will allow one of you to make a persuasion or an intimidate, depending on how you're approaching things.
I've been approaching it from the persuasive side of things, I hope.
Alrighty.
What is your persuade?
Right now it is a +9.
Ooh. I will let you do it then. Chris, can we aid? Can we roll the +1?
So that would be another, so that'd be 28.
Okay.
Oof.
Never mind.
Alright. So they kind of look at one another. Like, oh, how about 5 drachma? We got, well, he's got a kid to feed.
In case you have not noticed, gentlemen, by my visage, but I am a soldier in the military, and I would love to know which baron or person of wealth is taxing this road.
Like, again, they kind of look at one another. Like,
sweetheart, you can't feed your kid if you're not around. Just move along.
It would be the wiser course, especially when you're not collecting for an actual lord.
At this point in time, I put my helmet on my head, brandish my shield and my spear.
Okay. So they kind of look at one another, and they look not necessarily cowed, but they seem to be weighing the odds, and then they see Deacon kind of put his helmet on, and like, okay, you can pass.
Why, thank you. Glad to see that you have some intelligence.
And as you continue down the road, you can hear voices on both sides. Obviously, they had some friends waiting in the bushes, and their friends are like, what are you doing? It's like, they had a hoplite with them, and there's five of them, and they're a minotaur. I mean, we need to have a better plan. And they're like, but we could have, and they're like, there's a discussion as to whether or not they could have taken you or not. But it seems like the at least one of the ones that you directly spoke with seems to be the gang leader, for lack of a better term. Eventually, he just kind of pulls rank and says, just let them go. We don't need the trouble. It's not worth it for a couple of coin. Fine. But they let you pass unharassed.
Excellent.
Yay.
Probably a good thing. I imagine otherwise we were going to get a lesson in manners.
Well, there's no sense in having unnecessary violence.
No, not when they have a kid to feed.
Exactly.
There's no need to face.
I keep my
your
helmet on until I
figure the danger. Just find your fate.
Okay. But another couple of hours on the road, getting on to probably about afternoon-ish, early afternoon. And you come across what is very obviously the Sour Vintage Inn. The exterior is like, it's rustic, it's wooden, it's like painted black on the outside. There's a sign hanging from the door depicting a woman carrying a basket full of grapes. Even as you approach, you can hear some very light music being played within, and the sound of voices carrying, obviously people enjoying their noontime meal.
Well, I cannot speak for everyone else, but this is my current destination.
Sweet booze!
Likewise, it's also my stop.
Mine as well. Interesting.
So there is a like a menu printed, like posted outside. You can take a look, see what there is. They do have wine. They do have water. No ale. Ale is for barbarians.
Do they have Kiki on?
They do.
What time of day is it?
It's just just around noon-ish, a little bit after.
So lunch menu.
Yes, lunch menu. They're and inside you can see that the place is. It's not crowded by any stretch, but it is busy enough. There doesn't seem to be any wait staff per se. There's one innkeeper, female human. Looks like she's probably in her late 40s, and she's busy, but she doesn't seem overly busy. Like, she's very efficient at talking to the guests, clearing the tables, bringing out the food, so on and so forth. So she's constantly in motion, but doesn't seem like she's harassed or rushed or anything. And as you... Well, oh, go ahead.
Well, look for a table.
yeah, pretty much.
Yep. So the innkeeper... she kind of moves some things around to make a little bit of space for a centaur. You can tell that they don't get a lot of a lot of your people here. But yeah, she sets a corner for you, like a corner table for you. Make sure there's plenty of space for both you and for Sophia. And it's like, what can I get for you? My name's Atella. Welcome to the Sour Vintage. We prefer that if you have any disagreements with fellow customers, you take it outside. That's really the only rule.
Thank you for your most gracious offer. I'd try the kikyon, please.
Excellent.
And cheese and bread platter, I believe. I'm not very hungry, but peckish.
Excellent.
I will take wine and some salted fish, please.
All right. And everywhere you look around, like everybody is drinking wine. Doesn't matter what the meal is. Wine is the
Settle down, Sophia. You're trying to kill everyone in the room already?
Sophia is apparently just checking everything to see how it all works.
Laying waste to the tavern.
I promise I'm not trying to kill anybody.
Atella will bring out the orders. What else would anybody like?
I want to get the smoked fish with boiled eggs and some wine to go with that.
Excellent.
And I will get the spring water with roasted hare.
All right. So, some healthy appetites.
Where do I find how much coin I have?
It'll be
inventory page.
Yep.
I think we'll have I have 10 gold.
Oh, there it is. Okay, thank you.
That reminds me, I really should grab the coin conversion to throw them into Foundry for ease of
use.
Yes,
please. Yes, that would be nice.
I wrote it down.
But yes, the tavern itself is, like I said, it's busy, and it seems like a lot of people are grabbing their lunch, and then after they've eaten, they start to file out. But you do notice there is a fairly young woman, dark haired, who was playing the lyre as you walked in. And once you've kind of gotten situated. She puts her lyre down to the side, picks up a satchel that has what looks like dozens of scrolls and quills, and you can see some ink vials that are precariously packed away. It's my name's Kara. You might have heard of me. I'm the one I'm probably the one you're looking for. We don't get many groups of such assortment. So I would guess that you've heard about the call and are here to answer it.
Yes, you definitely sound familiar.
Excellent. Oh, this is great news. Okay, I'll be direct because I've been told that I have a tendency to not be direct, and I need to work on that.
So, well, why don't you have a seat?
Oh, thank you. So she pulls up a seat, and when she puts down her satchel, like clanks, like you can hear, and with all of the ink bottles knocking together, you're like, oh, this has the potential to be very messy. Okay, so I am here as an agent of the Oracle. She looks to see if any of you recognize that.
Oh, excellent.
Fia nods.
Okay, so the Oracle believes that great destinies await those who answer the call. But great destinies are forged by great deeds. You, destiny might be in store for you, but you need to meet it part way.
Such a rough translation. Life. Put the work in, and then you'll be part of destiny.
Yes.
Fate waits for no man or woman.
Understood.
So every great hero undergoes trials and tribulations before acclamation and fame. And I am here at the behest of the Oracle to guide you and chronicle your deeds. You have no doubt heard that there are unnatural creatures prowling the lands.
Yes, that depends on your definition of unnatural.
Monsters, hideous creatures. Heard somebody
she
that...
looks around the table, flutters her wings. Again, I guess that depends on your definition of unnatural.
Well, I mean, hideous creatures. There were those highwaymen.
True, exactly. See? I think they were pretty natural, though.
Yes, they were kind enough to let me go with paying only, like, a single coin, so... They seem nice.
Pay too much.
Yeah.
Highwaymen robbing people on a public road are not nice.
They said they had children to feed.
They were liars.
One of them had a child. One of them.
Regardless, it's not like coin is hard to come by. And maybe I made a friend, so there.
Seems like they've been working this scam for a while.
Perhaps.
If you have to buy friends, we can have words on better ways of doing it.
You don't have to buy them. True. But if your friends need assistance, then you give it to them. So if they need coin and I give it to them, then they're my friends. Very simple.
How are you still alive in this world?
I often wonder that myself.
So, what are these great deeds that we need to do to prove ourselves?
Okay. So, the first task before you, to prove yourselves worthy. There's a giant boar that is being laying waste to the heartlands, slaughtering everything in its path. That's a boar that has been corrupted by the Titans and sent to punish the mortals for their continued faith in the five gods. Not gonna lie, many before you have attempted to hunt the boar. If you wish, it is a way to gain fame and fortune, as great heroes should, and then that helps to prove to the people of Thylea that you are warriors worthy of the Oracle's prophecy.
Is it edible?
I don't see why not.
It's a boar.
But a creature of this magnitude should be offered as sacrifice to one of the gods. Now, I'm not going to lie, I do realize that not everybody does things out of the goodness of their heart. Some people are of a more mercenary bend. So with that in mind, my patron, the Oracle, has provided me with a means of payment. And she reaches into her satchel and she kind of rustles around and she pulls out a golden arrow.
That looks pretty.
It's entirely non-functional.
No, yeah. it's a price piece, not a shooting piece.
Yes, sadly gold won't penetrate any armor.
Unless it's enchanted.
But I do have... I do have these as payment. One each.
Well,
if being heroes isn't reward enough.
Well, heroes need to eat, so yeah.
There's a lot that can always be said for adding sweetness to the pot of life.
That is certainly a thing.
I mean, I will kill the boar for you anyway. Well, help them kill the boar. But if you're going to give me the golden arrow for doing it, I'll happily take that also.
Yes, I mean, once you kill the boar and then the oracle is satisfied that you are the ones in her vision.
Cool. So when are we supposed to do the thing?
That is entirely up to you. I merely provide opportunity and chronicle.
How far away is it?
Oh, it's not far. Perhaps a couple hours walk to the north. I did take the precaution, just in case. I'm not saying that you're not heroic and capable, but I did take the opportunity to hire a couple of hunters, because I don't know who's going to answer the call, and as I said, others have tried before and still have the arrows to give out. So I'm hedging my bets a little here. I think that's okay.
That's fair. I'm more of a lover than a fighter.
Well,
fortunately, I'm a fighter.
Well, should we take our repast and then move on to hunt the boar, then?
I assume we're all going to do this together. So far, we've just been a traveling party. Are we actually going to go do the fighting thing together now?
Well, if we're all here on similar business... That.
We have an option. We apparently are all of the people that are answering this call at this point in time, so we might as well make good on it.
I mean, it would be wiser to stay together.
If anyone here doesn't like someone else here, I'm sure if you waited around another group...
Armies are better than singles.
I think you are all awesome. I just want to double check that you are the war party that I am playing with, man.
I have no quarrel with any of you. You seem pleasant enough.
Agri just simply nods.
Well, perhaps where this is a trial for a fated party.
So who are these hunters you speak of?
She motions over to one of the tables, and you see two humans, they got like they're still wearing like their leathers. They've got like some short bows set aside. Like those are the folks that I hired.
You just pay them to sit here and wait for people to show up all day?
Well, I pay them to go with us when people are going out hunting. That one's Tanaeus and that one's Javin. They're pretty good folks. They know the way around. They're good at scouting. I don't want to presume, but she kind of looks around at the group. So I don't know how much skill you have when it comes to actually hunting.
My question to you would be, are they the only two that return from these adventures?
Oh, I just hired them this morning.
They haven't gone yet.
Oh, I see.
I had a feeling that something monumental was going to happen today, and I was like, you know what, Kyra, today is the day. Today's the day that one of these groups is going to succeed and come back. And then I thought, you know, what if they're city folk? What if they don't know how to swing a sword or a spear or... And then I thought, you know what? I should hire some people who can do that sort of thing. And here we are.
Well, that is super efficient and keen of you.
So, they're ready whenever you are.
Well, I'm waiting on a delectable drink and some food.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I'm going to have my fish and my cups first, and then we can do the hero thing.
When the tavern owner,
yes,
waitress, passes by, I'll order the chickpea and pear salad and some spring water.
Okay. Atella will kind of look at you a little little oddly. I'll make it a large salad.
That's fine. Would you like me to pay extra for it?
No, that's fine. I don't serve many minotaurs. I don't know. You look like one salad isn't going to be enough to sustain you.
I'll order two and make it easier.
Okay. So, I couldn't help but overhearing that you're going out hunting. You would be surprised how well hunting pays off. Many years ago in my youth, I hunted a creature similar to this boar, and eventually found my way to enough coin to purchase this inn. So, good luck. May the gods smile upon you. And as she says that, she does make the symbol of the evil eye, which Agri and Sophia, you know, whenever the five gods are invoked, people make that symbol to ward off the prying attention of the Titans.
So before we head off to meet what fate has in store for us, where this is a moderately epic task, perhaps we should swear an oath of fellowship. At least for the time being.
We can, if it would make your mind easier.
Well, that way it allows us to all share in the spoils amongst those who hear of our activities.
Yeah, Kyra's basically kind of like, you know, she seems excited at this idea.
Well, maybe she
I'm
wants
down.
She probably wants us to bring back the boar.
I don't think Jeff can hear me.
I can hear you now, because after the last session with all the static and background noise, I had actually put you on mute for a while.
Okay, because you've been talking over some of my role-playing in that as well.
There we go.
Now I can hear you.
I was curious, and I thought I would speak up now, because you did talk over the start of that sentence.
Well, yeah, it was... Yeah, I was like, who's missing? Someone's reacting to something, and I'm like, what the? Okay.
Okay, good. Yeah, that was a one-time deal anyway.
Yeah, you are totally, like, right now, loud and clear.
Yeah, I'm back at my computer where I have push-to-talk as opposed to where I thought I had it set up, and it wasn't, and I didn't find out till like, 2 hours into the pay-per-view.
I found out that my Windows 10 volume was set down to 20% as opposed to a more reasonable number. Which is why everything has been so quiet. Okay. So, yes. So, the Oath of Fellowship, for those of you that aren't aware, oaths in Thylea are... They are big things. That's a big deal. They are enforced by the bonds of fate. Breaking an oath has serious consequences. The Oath of Fellowship is fairly minor, but it does basically bond the group so that if one person in the group does something worthy of fame, everybody in the group benefits.
So we all become best buddies.
So if we get there, you know, and we get this epic plan together, we boost Deacon and he cuts it down to one blow. Instead of everyone going, man, that Deacon guy just killed that bull in one stroke, they went, that group, they did it together. He did the blow, but that group.
Oh, hail the heroes!
Kyra has basically gotten out like her quill and parchment and has basically been writing down like this momentous meeting sort of thing. Like, this is excellent. As I mentioned, part of my job for the Oracle is to chronicle things as you go.
Wonderful. We have our own court stenographer.
Hey, I kind of do that too.
Oh, excellent. We can compare notes and we can turn it into our contest.
Cool.
Whichever one of us writes the best poem when the trials and tribulations are done and the heroes have risen as high as they can, we will present our poems at the main theater in Mitros, and we will see who chronicled things better.
Battle of the Poets, I like it.
But yes, your friend does have a valid point. An oath of fellowship will bind your stories irrevocably together until you decide to go your separate ways.
Well, I think that's a fair thing considering what we're undertaking.
Yes, we're undertaking this trial together to prove that we are the one the Oracle foresaw together.
Yes, assuming we complete this trial together, then we are stuck together until the world is saved.
And I'm certain we all have our individual purposes or fate to pursue, but we'll likely find them together if we're drawn by the Oracle.
Hagri nods and says that he agrees.
Cool. Best buddies! Woohoo!
Kyra will look over at Sophia, who has remained quiet on this oath.
Yes, I agree.
Okay. So, yes, so...
So mote it be.
Right. There's a little bit more to that.
Yeah.
But Kyra says, okay, so, the Oath of Fellowship is... You swear upon your life and your honor that you will uphold the Oath of Fellowship with the warriors who stand with you.
Do we need to share blood for this?
No, but it is customary to drink wine with it.
Fair.
So it is an oath I am entirely in favor of.
Is there any objection if I have water instead?
No.
No, as long as we raise our glass.
Very well. Exactly.
Agri raises his glass of spring water.
Sophia raises his glass to his.
And give him a little smile. Well, as little as someone 7 feet tall can.
Yeah, so...
You could have a really tiny face.
Yeah. Well, you two are pretty much like eye to eye.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yep.
We're the most non-human.
Eleanor raises her glass of wine, like the cheapest wine they got. Kind of fluffs her wings a little.
Oh, that's right, you have wings, don't you?
Yeah, I'm 4 feet tall with a 6 foot wingspan.
Itty bitty. All these little tiny creatures.
Yep. So she's really got to look up at like the Minotaur and the Centaur. She's
not
like
hiding behind anybody.
Yeah.
All right. So your food comes. Everything is very well prepared. Nothing is over seasoned. Nothing is overcooked. It looks like Itella takes a great deal of pleasure and pride in her. Like there's nothing fancy, but she does take a great deal of pride in it. And you can tell, like, as she's serving you, she does have, like, a little bit of a smile on her face as she sees you kind of take the first bites and that sort of thing.
When Helen is eating and drinking, it's really the only time she stops making noise.
It's
kind of a relief, really.
Probably. Loud
eaters are kind of gross.
Agri starts digging into the roasted hair, almost like, you know, almost a barbaric.
Like he hasn't eaten in a while.
Like he hasn't eaten in a while.
Despite the two bowls of salad in front of her, Sophia just sort of picks at it. She eats slowly, thoughtfully, seems to say a little prayer beforehand. And she'll sort of nudge one of the bowls closer to the centaur.
Arathius eats as if he's sampling things. He takes one type of cheese on its own, one piece of bread on its own. Then he starts mixing and matching, trying them with a mouthful of his kikion. Seems to be experiencing things.
Deacon uses utensils.
I only have a cheese and bread to play. What do you expect?
I know, that kikion looks like an experience all on its own. No, gross.
Yeah, that does look pretty nasty on the menu.
Yes, it does.
I thought it actually looked kind of interesting, so...
I mean, maybe as a morning smoothie, but...
I was moderately intrigued by that.
No wine
it's
for breakfast.
It's basically a goat cheese milkshake, isn't it?
Yeah.
Not quite, but...
Only with wine instead of...
I have no... I'm trying regional fare. I've done this with other characters. I've done this in real life.
I'm partially tempted to try to make this, so...
Oh.
Barley is tasty, like a good red wine, and some...
And goat cheese is just so smooth.
Right. Like, I think it would actually taste pretty good.
You could probably
find a way to make...
Alright, but your meal is had. Everything is quite tasty. By the time you're done, it's probably 2 or so in the afternoon. You know, according to Kyra, it's a couple hours walk to where the boar is. So it's up to you when you would like to go.
Does the boar seem more active at night or during the day?
Well, generally during the day, but where it's been corrupted by Sidon, Lutheria, who is the goddess of the dark and night and all things therein, I don't know.
She's his wife, not his guide.
Yeah, wife, sister, I don't know.
Same thing.
Yeah.
It matters not. We either find it ravaging the land or we find where it's trying to sleep in the day.
True. I was thinking it might be more beneficial to attack it while it was trying to sleep or when it had already been through its day of activities or night of activities, depending.
Well, that had been what I was considering, because we would arrive...
Attack when it's tired.
Yes, we'd arrive towards late supper, and it would have already had a long day of ravaging.
Or it's possessed and mythical and evil and doesn't sleep.
Well, I mean, that is a possibility, I suppose.
That would be probably quite beyond us if it was that powerfully possessed.
Well,
and honestly, I would have far better faith in my ability to lose it in the dark than in the day.
What does it even do? Arathius, yes?
Yes, Arathius of Arisia.
What is it you do? Your name sounds familiar.
I have access to arcane abilities that don't quite fall into those of sorcerers or wizards. I'm a little more martial than them, but not like our friend Deacon here.
I've heard you made a pact with the Fates.
What being that seeks retribution does not in some way, shape, or form make a deal with the Fates, or at least reach out to them for information?
Hagrid just nods.
I heard you got banished after a dozen people met their fates mysteriously one night. You were the only one left standing.
Well, that's an interesting tale. I don't know the full details of that one myself. I have helped others find their way to their fate, but to be banished after a dozen? Intriguing. I wonder what the sisters would say then.
It sounded like a cool story. I like cool stories.
Speaking of cool stories, I've Helena, the bard.
Yes.
Yes. Knew I had heard your name before. I've heard things about you.
I've heard a lot about you, too.
Really?
Yeah.
That's odd.
I heard you've
done anything remarkable.
I heard you're a traveling teacher, and if your lessons get interrupted, it gets messy.
Oh, that could be a matter of some renown. I mean, it's not like Agrius here, who's taken down a Gigans with one stroke of his sword before he casts. He vowed not to use it unless he needed to as a druid.
See Agri pick up the salad that was passed to him earlier.
Sophia watches him. Nothing about the salad. She doesn't care about that at all. She had given it to him. But she is very curious about this rumor that he had killed somebody with one strike.
We're a party just full of stories, aren't we?
Yeah. Just to put things in context, you guys would be aware that a Gigan is it's a form of multi-armed cyclops. You've heard stories and tales of them. They're generally about like 9 to 12 feet tall, heavily muscled, multiple arms, one eye.
See, I had heard that Helena sang when a cyclops to sleep, but I hadn't heard about you defeating one quite so. I was going to say handily, but that seemed a bit much.
That's a little too on the nose.
Perhaps that's why Agrius is wanted by the druids of the Oldwood.
Really?
Ooh-hoo.
Really? She'll look at him again.
He just nods and then eats a salad.
Now, Deacon, are you changing your fate by traveling as an adventurer because of something you did while in service? Or because someone you cared for is no longer around?
My quest is for my family. They have all but disappeared, as if I was cursed by the gods, and I must try to find them.
Interesting. I do hope to learn so much more about each of you and your peoples and your lands.
Well, to clarify, yes, I am a traveling teacher, and yes, things can get...
I believe the word used was messy.
I don't appreciate my teachings being interrupted.
I can understand that. And what can I say? A cyclops loves a good lullaby.
And they are relatively easy to take down in one stroke if they are sleeping ahead of time.
Maybe it was the same Cyclops.
Did he have many arms? Because his did.
Oh, I can't remember now. What can I say? My mouth is pretty much my only weapon.
I heard, speaking of, that you killed someone with your song.
Yeah, they had really sensitive hearing. I might have exploded some eardrums.
Purview of the siren.
They're nice for a lullaby. Understood.
Yeah.
Or only ask for one when you're very sure.
Yeah. Only ask for a lullaby. When I say plug your ears in battle, plug your ears.
I will keep that in mind. Interesting.
So you guys while away an hour or so after lunch getting to know one another. And when would you like to head out?
I like soonest bestest, but I'm but one voice.
Yes, it's best to travel with the light.
I'm good whenever.
Agri gets up. I'm assuming I'm probably prone to actually be around a table.
Yeah, you would probably be like kneeling, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
They unfortunately do not have any chairs or anything suitable.
Centaur cot.
They don't have like a sitting bed or anything.
Just get him a nice hammock.
Well, let's furniture for.
Sophia wasn't too sure about the furniture, so she would have sort of melted as well.
The things you can do when you're young.
Yeah, right?
The perks of being human.
I'm perfectly fine as long as I keep my wings closed.
Yeah, but we have to put some books on your chair.
Probably.
I have books.
I am short. Like, really short.
So you guys finish off your lunch and get things together. Kyra motions for the two hunters who both get up and shoulder their packs and come and join you. They seem standoffish. They don't really come up and say, "Hey, how are you doing?" or anything like that. They just kind of get their things, and they seem to be following her lead as opposed to your lead.
What? Following the person that paid them? No.
Yeah, weirdly enough.
That's going to get them killed.
Hey, handsome, this probably is only going to work real well if you follow the actual fighters.
Well,
I'm saying this to the hunters.
Oh. I thought that was directed towards one of us.
Yeah, we'll, we can handle ourselves. I mean, we fought boars before. Not a big deal.
Oh, I don't doubt that, darling. But I have a feeling this is going to work best if we all work as a team.
Oh, of course, yes. And they kind of shoulder up their packs. And you can see, like, they've got like woodsman's gear. They've got like a hand axe for chopping wood, and you know, flint and steel and that sort of thing. Backpack, bedroll. You know, they're definitely outdoorsy type people.
So I'm actually going to go up to Deacon, because I assume he's going to be in the front, and Listen, I have this in my pack, and it might be really helpful hunting a boar, and I hand him my hunting trap.
Alright.
Sounds good.
How familiar are you with hunting with traps?
I got it to, like, occasionally catch food and stuff. I've been on my own for a while.
I've done whatever is needed to be done in the service of the military, so you gotta hunt for your own food while you're out there.
I have some experience in hunting.
I have some as well. I was strictly curious.
I'm pretty much one with nature. Agri laughs.
So you guys set off on the road out from the Sour Vintage, heading north. Kyra is kind of not necessarily. She doesn't come across like she's leading the way, but you can definitely tell that she has made this trek a couple of times. And there seems to be, for her generally upbeat personality, there seems to be like a little bit of a downturn to her, you know, you guys come to realize that, as she said, other groups have gone and done this. She's probably led them. She's probably been the only one to come back each time. And you can tell that it's starting to wear on her. But you make your way through the woods, up into like the low hills that lead into the mountains. And somebody can give me a survival check.
I have a +5.
That's better than my 3.
It is not gonna be me.
Me neither.
There you go.
All right. So as you start to make your way into the low hills that lead into the mountains, you can Agri kind of points out here and there. You see, like where the dried brush is kind of broken and pushed aside. A little bit of like dried blood here and there, and then you come across some very large sized boar prints. Bigger than your hoof prints, actually.
This is probably what we're looking for, Agri says.
Yeah. The prints are definitely far larger than any boar that you've seen before.
Sophia will step up and compare the size of her prints.
Yeah, larger than yours as well.
That's large.
Elena will flutter her wings and just kind of fall back to the back of the party.
And, Sophia actually can give me a perception check. You have advantage.
How do I do that?
On your character sheet, if you just click perception, yeah, it will roll for you.
Oh, that's convenient.
And then...
So the 17.
Yeah. And then advantage means you take the highest of the two numbers. Well, you've watched lots of Critical Role, you know.
Yes. Yes.
Yep. So on the air, you can smell blood mixed with various like earthy animal scents, enough for you to tell that the boar is somewhere within the range that you can smell. Granted, that's generally out to about 5 or 6 miles.
Which way is the wind blowing?
The wind, you guys are downwind.
All right, she'll point upwind that way. It smells like death.
Well, it's just about time to have it meet its fate.
So as you continue on for another 3 or 4 miles, you start to see, with Agri still following the tracks, and the two hunters stopping periodically to kind of converse with them to make sure that everybody's still, you know, in agreement that this is the right direction to go, sort of thing. You kind of come up like one of the little hills, like that, as I said, they lead into the mountains, and you can see there's down in the valley between the hills, there's like a thick blanket of fog hanging over the lower land. But you can pick up, there's like just this path of wanton destruction through the very sparse trees and forests that are here. Like, some of the tree trunks have been split asunder. There's splatters of blood. There's one section of the ground where it looks like something very violent happened. A bunch of the grass is all trampled and covered with now dried blood. And you can all hear like ear-splitting grunts and squeals coming from just, you know, kind of, you're at the top of one hill, and then there's a little valley, and then up on the other hill is where you can hear this squealing sound. And everybody can give me a perception check.
Nice 20.
Yeah. And Jeff is rolling like it's Torg.
Yep.
Nice fail, and then exploding 20.
Yes. So Agri's kind of like concentrating on the ground, on the tracks, the trail of destruction. But the Sophia and Helena and Arathias, you can see on that kind of the next hill across from this little valley, you can see what looks like a cave entrance on the side of the hill. And it's not like it's not a steep hill. It's more like a rolling gentle hill. But you can see a cave entrance.
I kind of steer Deacon in that direction. Dude, over there.
What's the range on a light crossbow? When I hover over it, it shows it off my screen for some reason. I can't actually see.
80 feet to a maximum of 320.
Okay. Yeah. How far do I figure roughly it is to the cave entrance?
From here, from one hill to the other, maybe 100 feet.
I'll pull out a light crossbow.
I don't know why, but I'm expecting to find a little white rabbit here.
What? Oh. Oh.
And again, you hear some squealing and grunting sound from that cave.
Agri takes his shield off of his back and withdraws out his scimitar.
Okay. Home sweet home.
Are we going into initiative?
Not quite yet, because it doesn't know that you are there.
Okay.
Do you think you could lure it out into the open?
I probably could with a song. Make enough noise.
Can I see into the cave at all?
From here you can see like the entrance to the cave, but you can't really see into the cave from here.
So if that's what y'all want me to do, I can make a performance and try and lure it out. But I don't want to call it to us if that's not what we want to do.
No, because it will likely come straight at you.
Yeah. So, I'll let y'all get ready. And I'm going to give our hoplite a bardic inspiration.
Okay.
So I sing a little bit of a rock song kind of softly, and basically I give Deacon an extra d6. So for the next 10 minutes, you can roll the die, add the number rolled to one ability check, attack roll, or saving throw it makes. You can wait until after the d20 is rolled before deciding to use the Bardic Inspiration die, but must decide before the DM says whether it succeeds or fails. Once it's rolled, it's lost.
And Chris, you said that cave was how far away?
It's about 100 feet or so. Basically, it's kind of over in this direction on the map. So your two hunters basically start to kind of sneak forward, you know, kind of get into positions.
Sophia pulls out a crossbow, knocks it, kind of braces it, and then looks like she's waiting for something. She's got her right hand is on the trigger, but her left hand, she's got kind of in an odd pose. Like she's waiting.
Arthias moves forward slightly, but most disconcerting of all is the fact he's carrying no weapon.
I move back, pull out a crossbow, and hold my breath.
Again, you hear the grunting, snuffling type sounds.
Egri moves forward.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll make a line.
Tell me when to sing. I need to move back. Where is the boar?
The boar's not on the map yet.
The cave is over here.
Yeah. It's to the lower left, lower right.
Oh, okay. I see it now. Sorry.
I'll make sure I'm not shooting the centaur in the back.
Appreciate
good
it.
Good idea.
Thought you might.
I believe that there's no time like the present, Sophia. To have Helena sing. What do you think?
Bring it on.
I think now seems good.
Okay, I will start performing a rock ballad.
Wow.
Yeah.
Make a performance.
She was waiting for her moment.
Awesome.
Told the guy with the song. Uh-huh.
With Helena, so she's currently in the sorrowful stage, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So the song, you guys can feel it. Like, you've heard rumors and legends about the sirens and their music, and the song that she sings just like almost drives you to utter despair. Like, it is heart wrenching.
I'm currently listening to My Immortal by Evanescence, if that helps.
I would have figured he would have gone for War Pigs from Black Sabbath myself, but.
No, she's a sad bard. I'm an emo bard.
But yeah, you see this this gigantic boar head come out of the cave and kind of snuff around. And then it just basically charges down and just hits Tanaeus, one of your hunters, smack, and basically impales him on its tusk. Through his, right through his chest.
Welcome to stay with the party, man.
Yikes. Dude,
well,
dumb. We're rolling initiative.
And now we are going into initiative, yes.
What do I click?
Same as Alien, it's in the combat, the cross swords part. You can just click the die beside your name.
Ah, gotcha.
Yeah, or on your character sheet where it says init, you can click that as well.
How appropriate.
Wow.
That was horrible.
Okay, I'm having a moment. Where is this on the character sheet?
It's the first one just before strength, and it...
Yeah, it's right between your shield and your stats.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah.
Okay.
And for those of you that are not used to it, if you right-click on the crossed sword icon, it'll basically pop out the combat tracker if you want to keep the combat tracker handy.
Well, this isn't going to go well.
Kyra, what will Kyra do?
Well, since you're using that mod, I don't have to keep the combat tracker pop. Jeez.
Yeah, I love the turn.
It's a great mod.
The turn marker mod is amazing. So yeah, if you're watching the stream and you use Foundry, turn marker is your friend. So Kyra, not to be outdone, she starts to sing, but her song is very upbeat and uplifting. And it's a tale of previous heroes going back over the centuries. To the coming of the Dragon Lords and how the Dragon Lords arrived with their dragons to protect the mortal races from the Titans and so on and so forth. Until the end of Kyra's next turn, each of you gets to re-roll a die of your choice.
Cool.
Neat.
The boar. Oh, that's within range.
He's not going to sit there and tell us of his lineage like the great boar he is?
He is not.
He's saving that until we're all, you know, incapacitated and can't get away, so he's got a captive audience.
But it is going to hit your other hunter for 21 damage.
He picked really... It's a good thing these people are not the last line of defense.
And as it moves closer, you guys can see now it has like arrows and spears sticking out of its hide from where previous attempts to kill it have failed.
How tall is this thing?
It's probably about 5 feet at the shoulder. That will bring us to Deacon.
Oh boy. Messy. What's the range on throwing the spear?
Throwing the spear, it should be 20 feet, 60 feet. So within 20 feet, it's normal. Between 20 and 60, you're at disadvantage.
It's at 25.
All right, I'm going to move up about 10.
Okay. So yeah, every square is 5 feet, so.
And chuck.
So yeah, on your, if you just click the picture for your spirit, there you go. Perfect. Oh, good, solid hit.
Sweet.
So you move forward a little bit and you launch the spear and it jabs into like the kind of the shoulder joint, joining many other spears that are already there, but definitely hitting and embedding.
Excellent.
Would you like to do any more movement or anything, or?
I would like to draw my longsword.
Okay, yeah, that doesn't take any action or anything.
Yep, that sounds good. I will stay where I am and put out the shield and brace for what's probably going to be an attack.
Gotcha. Okay. Arathius.
I will look at that great boar and I will channel the energies of my pact to try and affect it with chill touch.
Ooh, chill touch.
Well, shite.
Remember, because of Kyra's song, you do get to reroll a die.
Yeah, I'll take the reroll there. Do I just use the advantage results instead, or roll again?
Just roll again.
Okay. Range spell attack. Yay.
Excellent. Cold pork. Okay.
So you reach out. So what does your chill touch look like for the people that see it?
Alongside its shoulder, bristling with spears and arrows, suddenly a skeletal hand made of ice appears and grasps the bristling flesh of the boar, and you see it freeze at its touch as it latches on.
So the chill touch reaches on and grabs, but the boar does not seem to be affected by the chill.
Dang.
Its armor class is slightly higher.
Yeah, that's what I was hoping. I could use the advantage and then saw that second roll.
Yeah. Agri.
Does it still do the damage, though?
No.
No. No, it would have been nice, because it also means it couldn't heal if it has any healing.
So Agri puts his sword back in his holster and then goes ahead and produces a flame in his hand.
Okay.
And then shoots it at the boar.
Alright. So is it like a normal colored flame, or is it like a colored flame?
Yeah, I'd say it's a normal colored flame, basically. Slowly appears in his hand, and you basically see Agri gesture towards the boar, and it basically launches.
Okay. And it goes out and it like, strikes the boar like fairly directly in its torso. Helena.
I'm assuming it's too dumb to understand if I use vicious mockery, so I'm just gonna shoot at it.
It doesn't. Vicious Mockery, I don't think the creature is required to understand you. It's one of the great things about the spell.
Oh, well then I will attempt a Vicious Mockery and we'll see what happens.
So a wisdom save.
Yes.
A 12. So it will take a little bit of psychic damage.
Yeah.
And
you stupid animal.
Disadvantage on the next attack roll.
Yeah. Because I pissed it off.
No, you made it cry at all your insult.
Yeah.
Sophia.
Yes. For spell work, are cantrips considered a bonus action?
It depends. Most cantrips are not bonus actions, no.
Okay.
It'll say in the spell description if it's a bonus action. Off the top of my head, clerical spells that are bonus actions are Healing Word and Spiritual Weapon. There's others at higher levels, but those two are the big ones.
Okay. I was hoping it would be slightly farther away, but that's okay. That hand that she was kind of bracing her crossbow on, her left hand. She twirls her hand around and then sort of gestures to it, to the boar, and mutters something under her breath, and a flash of light streaks from her hand. Now, how do I get a spell to cast here in...
It might be on your macro bar if you recognize the image or hover over the name. Otherwise, in your spell book, if you hover over it, it changes the icon to a die, and you just click that.
Oh, yep. Okay, I clicked. Nothing happened. I'll try it again.
You click the die part.
Oh, there we go. There we go.
The six is a miss, but you do get to roll the attack again because of Kyra's song.
Okay, so it rolled two dice from what I can see here.
Yep, it's faster that way. That way, if you always take the first die, if you have advantage, you take the highest. If you have disadvantage, you take the lowest.
Okay, so I have advantage currently?
No.
No, we just have a reroll.
Oh, yep. Okay.
Yeah, you get to reroll. There. Oh. 20 is a hit.
Yes, I hope so.
And more radiant damage.
Yeah.
Yep. Oof, that damage.
It takes, 46 radiant damage, and the next attack roll made against this target before the end of my next turn has advantage. Because it has a dim mystical light glittering around it, so it's easier to see.
Perfect. That will bring us to Kyra. Huh. Kyra is quite impressed at what you guys have been doing. But she sizes up the boar, and she changes the tempo of her song, changes the beat a little bit, but talking about how the perseverance of the dragon lords saw them through many a tough time. Now the boar is bleeding fairly heavily from the weapons that are already in it, and Deacon's is just added to that. So it takes a level of exhaustion, but it does charge right at Deacon. Not quite far enough to get its charge damage, so it's only a tusk.
And it's a disadvantage, right?
It is a disadvantage.
Yeah, they were both good rolls, though.
Yeah, they were. Ouch.
So that is going to be an 18 to hit. And for 14 damage on Deacon.
Now, what am I looking on my compare that against?
Your armor class.
So the shield underneath your speed.
I have an 18.
All right, so it does connect for 14 damage. And I think you have 13 hit points?
I think 12, actually.
Okay. So the boar slams into you like full tilt, and you guys can see Deacon just about drop. Make a Constitution saving throw. All right, so you have one hit point, but just as you're about to drop, Kyra's song seems to penetrate and give you just this extra level of resolve, and you shrug off what would probably have been a fatal blow, and remain on your feet.
Cool.
And you're up.
Taking one for the team.
I think it took a lot more than one there.
So how does the second wind work?
It's a bonus action. So on your turn, you get movement and you get an action, and then you can do one bonus action if you have a thing that requires a bonus action. So if you want to use your second wind, it'll heal you slightly. It's a D10 plus your fighter level. And then it comes back on a short rest or a long rest. And then if you just click it should roll it for you.
Can I do that at any time prior to
on your turn, as a bonus action? Yes.
Yeah, so I will no need to move, so I will lay some sword into this thing. We'll go from there.
Okay. And you do have advantage from the glowing light that's surrounding it. It seems to be almost where Sophia, I imagine where your goddess is the goddess of knowledge. The guiding bolt is probably almost like highlighting vulnerable areas on the target, providing the next person with the knowledge of where to strike better. It's a good solid hit. So Deacon, remaining on your feet, you kind of like spin around, grab your sword, and jam it into one of the glowing areas of the boar. And when you pull it out, like a gout of blood flows out, and it's bleeding pretty freely here.
Cool. Hopefully it's on its last legs. I will also second wind myself, so as a bonus action, so that I can heal up.
Perfect. Excellent. 7 points. That's pretty decent.
Nice.
Arathius.
Well, time to go to the good old, and since it's right there, I think I'll attempt to Eldritch Blast it.
Okay.
Oh my god.
This is to make up for the good rolls that you got.
I know.
For part of Alien. Not all of Alien, but part of it. So yeah, as big as this creature is, the fact that it's still standing after like gushing this blood and watching Deacon not 10 feet from you take that blow that you know probably would have killed you outright, you're like, and your aim is a little bit off. That would bring us to Agri.
Well, it worked last time. Agri reignites his hand and shoots another one towards the boar.
Okay.
We're almost there. Give it everything.
And you mentioned that was at advantage?
No, just the next attack because of the guiding bolt. So,
oh, okay.
So yeah. The sword was advantage. The yeah. one that didn't need it.
Yeah. Just the one.
Yeah. Yeah. So you launch the fire at it, and it does hit it, but it like singes off some of the hair and everything, but otherwise seems to have very minimal effect.
Is there still the reroll from Kayla?
No, that was until the end of her next turn.
Gotcha.
Her different songs do different things. This particular song allows anybody who would drop to zero to make a constitution check to see if they remain at one hit point.
Oh, so I benefit from that, yes.
In hindsight, that was a good call. All right, Helena.
Hey, sure, let's go with the vicious mockery again. You stupid boar, you couldn't even take down one lousy fighter. You're useless.
Ouch.
She's so mean.
It is not.
Man, I'm stupid that one myself.
I hurt his feelings.
And the hoplites calling him just a simple fighter.
Trying to insult the boar, not you, buddy.
I think it was the word lousy.
Sorry.
Have you checked your gear for lice recently?
I didn't think vicious mockery was area of effect, but wow.
Only mine.
Sophia.
Yes. I can see past the centaur and the human.
Yes.
So I'm going to try to hit it with my crossbow.
Okay. Yeah, the like shoulder of the boar, it comes up to like probably about Deacon's shoulder, and then the size of its head is like above that. It is a massive creature.
That's a huge boar.
So, yeah, I'm shy of 6 feet, so yeah, that's pretty big.
Yeah.
It's definitely larger than I would like. So what am I clicking here?
Under inventory, light crossbow. Or it might be on your hotbar.
I don't see it on my hotbar, and I can't get my action to open on the inventory page. Let me just...
Same thing, it should turn into a die when you hover over it, and you can just click the die.
I couldn't expand it. It wouldn't even go to the...
If you click on it, does it expand it?
No, I think it wouldn't even go to the inventory page. So,
it shows that I have an empty section for my inventory page.
If you hit F5, it should just redo the Foundry page for you.
Nothing happened. Give me a sec. I'll do it manually and see what happens.
Okay.
There it is.
Oh, 17 is a hit. So you you line up your light crossbow and fire into it, and the bolt sticks into it. It's looking hurt. It's gushing blood everywhere.
Are the two hunters who came with us? Are they obviously dead?
Oh God, yeah.
Are they possibly still alive down there?
They are possibly still alive. You won't know until you go up to check them, but they're laying on the ground very, very still.
All right.
I mean, but the first one took 21.
Or anything, or crushed skull or something like that.
Well, the very first one was run through by those giant tusks, and then the second one took a lot of damage.
And they are just mere mortals.
True.
Kyra will continue performing her Song of Perseverance. The boar. Oh, it's got a fighter right here. But it's also... what's it got? It'll do this. Everybody that was in 40 feet of the boar and aware of it must make a wisdom saving throw.
Mm.
Oh, yeah.
That's everybody then.
Yeah.
Wow, that's the highest die I've rolled. That's probably not enough.
Ow. That sucks.
Yikes.
Okay. So Helena and Deacon. Deacon, don't forget, you do have the D6 you can add if you so choose.
Yes.
Oh, I will so choose.
Yes. So that will make you 16 because the DC on it is 10. So only Helena is affected.
Oh. Awesome.
It sang back at you.
Yeah. It did.
Yeah. as the
stupid boar.
It doesn't, but you feel like the boar's presence, there's something about it that's just not right. There's something about it that is like infringing upon this space. There's almost like another hand at play in this, manipulating the boar. And as you start to contemplate that for a second, you get confused.
Oh, that's why I'm a siren. I know what that feels like.
Oh, it's not natural, Lassie.
Right, Deacon is up.
Okie McDokies. I will have at it with the sword.
That's what the Chaos Presence does. Alright. Oof. Some good rolls there. Alright, so you jab into it and you almost come out the other side. And when you pull your arm out, you're pretty sure you pull something vital out as the ore is like heaving and wheezing.
Ew.
Yeah, like a drawback and I've got like a lung or something.
Yeah.
That is awesome.
That is so gross.
Arathius.
Well, perhaps this time I will help it meet its fate.
Put it out of its misery.
Oh my god, I hit!
So what does your Eldritch Blast look like?
As I have made a pact with the outside, it is crackling black lightning, like a void passing through the air.
So the exact opposite of my guiding bolt.
If you look closely, you might see script, but it's hard to tell if that's just the madness of the void or not.
Oh, this is going to be a fun party.
We're just going to have to call the two of you yin and yang.
I need to remember not to sleep next to him.
All right. So this blast of black arcane energy reaches out and strikes the boar, kind of like center of mass, and you see it just kind of start to wither. And how would you like to do this?
Well, I think that I would consign the extra energies that made it so much larger to my patrons, leaving the husk of what it originally was behind.
So as the black energy strikes the boar, you guys see it withers and it starts to shrink and then shrink. And as it does, the various assorted spears and bolts and arrows that were in it, basically some of them fall off until it turns into the size of a normal, everyday, regular boar, just kind of expiring there. At Deacon's feet.
I help it expire faster.
As it does, all of you in your heads hear a booming voice. It says, "Know this, mortals, your sins cannot be atoned. An ancient power sleeps in the heart of Thylea, and when it awakens, the age of Mitros will come to an end. Just as my broken body falls to ruin and decay, so too do all mortal things come to death and darkness. No prophecy will save you."
Chris, can you type that into the chat so that I can write it down for the epic poem?
I will do so.
Thank you.
Everything dies. This is no surprise to anyone.
I spit on it and then utter for pythos.
Everything in its time, everything in its place, as fate ordained.
All right, now, please, to all the gods, tell me there's a stream nearby I can get cleaned up in.
There is a little stream, yes.
Sophia's going to run down to those two hunters. Are either of them hanging on to life?
I will go with her.
I moved to where there was a hunter one.
Let me see, it's been 3 turns. Yes, they are both still barely clinging to life.
I got this one, you got that one?
Sounds good.
Cure wounds, I assume, is what we're doing. One hunter's back up.
I kind of sit there, like, settling on my haunches as I watch you work. Curious.
Near Sophia.
Whoever decided to get the one closest to where the boar died, because the other one died a good distance away, which would have been a straight line for Sophia.
Okay, well, I probably would have got the one next to the boar then, I guess.
Then you.
Okay.
Oh no.
Well, you have spells.
Yes, but it's not letting me cast it. It tells me I have no spell slots. I had the reroll earlier.
Let me see. What spells did you cast? Oh, that's...
cast the one. Right. Cast guiding.
Right. That's right. It's easy enough. You can just add spell slots in manually. Just type it in. So there you go. You should be good.
Do you want me to roll it again? Or just stick with the two?
Well, it's a different roll.
Yeah. It's a different roll.
Yeah. It's a D8 plus your wisdom modifier.
As opposed to, like, trying to roll your medicine or whatever.
There you go.
That's right. Better. Sophia and Helena basically rush up to the two hunters. They are grievously wounded. To the point where I think each of them, one of them was like one failed death save away from death, and the other one was two away. So they're fucked up.
I kneel behind the head of one of them, sort of lift his head into my lap and mutter a few words as I'm stroking his hair back away from his forehead.
Whereas I gently touch the other one's face, kind of almost like lovingly, and sing like a romantic hymn.
Such a contrast. Interesting.
And as you guys are doing this, the rest of it, you would have seen Kyra started walking up, and she pulls out like a couple of coins in her hand. And then as she sees Sophia and Helena get to work, she puts them back in her purse.
Yes, no need to pay the ferry toll. They've not met their fate this day.
It is always worth ensuring that the dead have the proper toll. I'm glad that I'm glad that this went the way that it did.
I retrieve my spear.
Okay.
Let's go get some booze back at the bar.
Ari points over at the cave and says, "Do we have to worry about anything there?"
Well, we should check the cave in case there's stuff of use.
What if there's more than one?
And we shall dispose of it.
If there's more than one and didn't come out to the cries of battle of its mate, companion, father, sire, mother, then it's not long for this world.
Can any of you see in the dark?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Do any of you need help seeing in the dark?
Well, I do not.
Cool.
So, no seeing in the dark for us humans.
Well, that's why I said, do you need help seeing in the dark? I will go up and cast light on something on your character.
How about my shield?
Sure.
Okay. So the shield starts to radiate with a basically about the equivalent of a torchlight.
Yeah.
Still see beyond its aura anyway. It's nice.
Everybody needs to be able to see, not just those of us with dark vision.
So you make your way into the cave, and it goes back a little ways, probably 15, 20 feet or so. There's a couple of bodies just inside. It looks like the boar was in the process of consuming them.
Those could use coins.
Those could definitely use coins.
I probably am not the one to know this, but the druid might. Is it typical behavior for boars to eat flesh? I thought they were herbivores.
Boars are omnivores. They're opportunity eaters.
They are absolutely omnivores.
Yep.
Okay.
That's why they're the most tricky thing to hunt in the swamps.
But both Agri and Sophia would know that it's proper custom to bury or burn the dead, and that the body should have a gold piece over each eye.
So Agri takes two, apologize for can't remember the coinage here, two silver equivalent, and puts it over one of the corpses, and then produces flame.
Okay.
There were how many corpses in here?
Two.
Okay. I'll pull the other one over.
Okay.
So that it can light off the first one, basically. And put a gold over each eye.
Gotcha. And as you move that body, the coin purse kind of falls like off the belt sort of thing.
Someone want to grab that?
Yes, I have it.
So the one of them had a coin purse and the other one had a very, very well made, very sturdy spear. But in the glimmering light of Deacon's shield, you can tell that the tip and probably about another 4 or 5 inches, like basically the actual spear tip itself and then the metal part that bolts onto the wood, has been covered encased in silver. With some like very fine etching on it.
Seems like overkill.
Deacon, this may be of use to you. I don't think it is strictly a mundane weapon.
I'll have a look at it.
Sophia says a short prayer over the bodies.
Unfortunately, I don't have a certain item that costs 100 gold, so I can't just cast Identify if it's magical or not.
I will join Sophia's prayers with a song of mourning.
Okay. So as you look over the spirit again, it's definitely well made. It's definitely seen some use. This is the sort of thing that you would expect as was probably a gift. Or something that, like somebody like a little bit higher in station, or maybe a noble that, you know, wanted to go spear hunting would have. It's definitely functional and it's well made, but it's not any lighter or anything of that nature. But the tip is silver.
Hmm. Interesting. I'll take it with me and attempt to research this further.
Okay.
Spear's a spear to me. I've never wielded one. I don't know the difference in weight, balance, or anything.
Well, part of it is, too, though, the fact that there are some items through the antiquity of time that may be better or at least better made, if not potentially even blessed by the gods. So it's possible, but probably not likely, but it's worth looking into. I'll just, you know, consult some history texts.
All right, so with Sophia and Agri's ministrations, you can send these two corpses on to their proper ending. But as you, you're sending these corpses on their way, it dawns on you. Actually, which one of you has the highest intelligence? How intelligent is our party?
I have 12. I am smart.
I have 11.
11.
13.
Ding, ding, ding. So it dawns on Sophia that you, Kyra had mentioned that you were expected to sacrifice the boar to one of the gods.
I thought he did when he blasted.
I consigned its energies to the fates. I didn't sacrifice the body yet.
Exactly. Oh. A sacrifice is a very specific thing that has to be done.
We need to sacrifice the boar.
Is there anything else in the cave?
No.
Okay. Well, then I will go out and start looking for branches and sticks and things under the direction of our cleric, who looks like the most knowledgeable person about god sacrifices.
I will go seek a water source.
I have done one or two over the years.
Yeah, there's a little stream nearby where you can get cleaned up.
Good.
Cleaned up, it's refreshing. It's a little brisk. I mean, it's a mountain stream.
Oh, that's good.
But it wakes you up and it gets the circulation going.
Well, basically, yeah, because if I don't get the armor cleaned, it's hard on the armor. And the swords and everything else. Oh, and it'll attract things that might want to come try to eat us.
Yes, all very true. So you guys can tell that Deacon's not just somebody who like talks the talk, as it were. He definitely, the way he's taking care of his gear and his equipment, this is somebody who's reliant upon that sort of thing and having everything, you know, in good condition.
That's what keeps him alive.
Yeah. Exactly.
Considering the boar's recent history, I don't think it's too much of an ask, but he may have wiped it out. Has he felled a tree or two that we could just use the logs?
Yes. There is definitely some shattered trees and everything from the boar that you can use to build a sacrificial pyre.
Excellent.
And the big question is, which god would you like to sacrifice the boar to?
I certainly have my preference.
Same.
I'm going to defer to the cleric-y people, because I am so not the person to ask.
I choose Lutheria.
I choose crap.
I battled it, so Pythor's happy.
I have my deity written here somewhere.
Your deity is Valis.
No, actually.
Not the goddess of wisdom?
Sort of.
It's the cow god.
There was... Minotaurs are just slightly a step to one side, yes.
But yes, Valis is the goddess of knowledge and wisdom.
I mean, Mitros isn't a bad idea, just because, you know, we're coming into a time of troubles like Mitros has helped the mortals against.
He's going to dedicate it to Thylea and Valis.
Okay. Has to be one.
Oh, Thylea then.
The Titan. The Great Mother.
Go back into the land.
Okay.
Again, I'll just sing a hymn, but this time it sounds a little bit more forced than some of her other performances.
Double check something here.
You can very clearly tell Helena's not into it this time around.
Prove to the Oracle that you're the heroes. They're going to stop the Titans. We dedicate this kill to the Titan.
Are
He sounds like the nicest Titan, I guess.
It's kind of like hedging your bets.
She is the Earth Mother.
Precisely.
It's one of those things that not all of the Titans are necessarily evil, not all of the gods are necessarily good.
They can all be jerks equally. I don't say that out loud.
So as you...
I mean, we got Kyra right here with us. Let's ask her.
I merely share a name. So as you...
Coincidental.
As you light the sacrificial pyre and your two... your cleric and your druid kind of come to a consensus on dedicating the sacrifice to Thylea, who is the Earth Mother, the goddess that represents the entire world. As the boar starts to smoke and burn, and the smoke starts to rise up into the heavens, all of you feel invigorated. Almost like the eyes of the gods are upon you, and it fills you with a sense of confidence. And a certain buoyancy in your step. The effect of it does not necessarily heal, but each of you has the charm of vitality. You have to choose to activate it, but once you do, it removes any exhaustion you have, it cures any disease you have, it cures any poison you have, and for the 24 hours after you activate it, you regain the maximum number of hit points for any hit die you spend.
Cool.
Charm of what?
Charm. Meat. Charm of vitality.
That'll be useful in the future.
And as the sacrifice is accepted, you all feel this like deep thrumming heartbeat underneath your feet.
That's interesting.
And both Agri and Sophia realize that Thylea has accepted your sacrifice.
The smile passes over Agri's face.
Thank you. With her head tilted back and her eyes closed.
As Sophia sits with her eyes closed, you sense a presence that looks upon you sadly, but also smilingly.
One that we have not felt in a long time.
One that you have not felt in a long time. You would know that your father is aware.
Well, now I'm committed.
This is still just interesting.
So as the smoke rises from your sacrifice, it is getting on towards evening. Do you want to camp overnight, or do you want to make your way back to the Sour Vintage, and knowing that it will be It will definitely be dark by the time you arrive.
But it won't be very late at night, though.
True.
To the tavern.
I'm fine either way.
Don't like sleeping in houses?
Sophia leans in close. Neither do I.
Well, I'm sure we can find accommodations.
Particularly like sleeping in fields. Not, I'm gonna put that out there. I'm kind of a city girl. I mean, maybe by a stream or something, but even a stream's pushing it. Give me a beach. A beach.
We have to return there eventually anyway.
Exactly.
I'm fine.
Let's head back.
Like I said, it's fine either way. Sophia takes point at the back of the group.
As Darkston starts to settle, Arathius puts his hood over his head while he walks.
I'll take Lee.
Helena kind of fluffs and settles her wings in again and keeps walking.
Most interesting encounter.
You keep saying that. We all just a bunch of, like, science experiments to you?
Experiment? No, this is experience.
You keep saying it because it keeps being true. Saying it doesn't make it untrue.
I suppose.
I could adopt other options if you'd rather. I could just, like, quietly rub my hands together and cackle to myself.
It's unnerving. It's very unnerving.
Excellent.
Agri will grab a torch from his pack and light it using produce flame.
Isn't your shield still glowing? How long does my light last?
I believe light lasts for an hour.
Yeah, his shield should be still glowing then.
Sweet.
Okay.
Yeah. But yes, as you guys make your way back to the Sour Vintage. It's oddly calm. And periodically you find like small woodland creatures just walking alongside you. And not just innocuous ones, but at one point you see, you know, some wolves that look like they're actually probably a little bit hungry, but they just walk along beside you, almost like a protective guard or like an honor guard sort of thing. And periodically as you walk, like once they get to the edge of their territory, they like, you know, disperse back into the wild, and something else comes and kind of takes its place.
Christ, I feel like a Disney princess.
What is this Disney?
Bonus is sacking things to an Earth Mother.
You don't look like a princess, if it's any consolation at all. I would know.
Fair.
How do you know a princess, Sophia?
Maybe she looks in the mirror.
I know a lot of things.
That's fair.
Do you want to build a kingdom?
Shut up.
I drink water and I know things.
Don't even start.
As it gets into the late hours of the night, not quite midnight, by the time you get back to the Sour Vintage, it is the taverna itself is fairly empty at this hour. Most respectable people have, you know, had their supper, had their wine, and have gone off to bed for the small farms and stuff that are around here. So the tavern itself, the inn itself, is essentially it's yours. The owner Alatea is still here, or Alita, I can't remember what I called her.
Atela?
Atela. She's still here. There's still like some leftovers that are still warm. If you want something to eat.
I am starving.
Is there... There's no temple in this town, is there?
There's not even a town here. There's like a... There's the taverna, and there's... and there's a couple of farms. But you're about 20 miles east of Estonia.
I'll take some goat sausage and then retire to the roof.
Very well.
What was the menu again?
It's under the broken... Rosetta Stone beside the urn. Sour vintage menu.
Thank you.
And Kyra will pull up a chair. She'll get some wine and some food.
I will take wine and goat sausage. Sounds great.
Chickpea and pear salad and some more water.
Very
water
well.
And hedgehog.
We may have to refer to the salad as a special.
It's a different salad at least, but I'll still take two.
That was truly impressive. As I said, others have attempted this first task, and well, that was impressive.
Hey, we're still alive.
You are. The only thing remaining at this point is for the Oracle to verify that you are the heroes that she saw in her prophecy. Versi is, she's ancient. She was around during the swearing of the Oath of Peace. Some stories say that she negotiated, or she was partial to the negotiation of the oath. She is not someone who chooses their heroes lately, and there's a reason why when she gives forth a prophecy it is generally heeded. She is the daughter of Sidon, but is an ally to the mortal races. But when you feel up to it, I can lead you to her temple and we can see for ourselves if you are who she thinks you are. And once we do that, then the golden arrows are yours.
Morning sounds like a good time for that.
I agree. There's bound to be a stable around here I can sleep in.
Are there any rooms attached to this taverna?
Yes, they do have rooms. It's they have a couple on the ground floor, and they have a couple on like the upper floor. And they do have room, like a room that is large enough for centaurs. They don't get many of them, but they do have a room that can be purposed for such.
It's part of why she knew how to move the chair so you'd have room.
Yes.
Well, she has the accommodations. I'll reside within the building. It's been a while.
Well, stay outside.
And no, I will stay on the roof.
I certainly require a good night's sleep.
How much are your rooms?
It'd be a couple of drachma each.
Okay. We conveniently have a pouch of coin.
We do too.
Yeah, it might pay for everyone.
Yes,
it might, but it was just a pouch.
So as you kind of like set at the table, kind of counting out the coin, there are. Where are my coins thing? There are 25 gold staters and 37 silver drachma.
More than enough. Might I make a suggestion?
Sure. Well,
sure.
Going forward, it's probably a good idea if whenever we find funding, that we pool it for all and not just for individuals.
So rather than split it up, we just keep it in one pouch?
Yes, pretty much. That way we have funds that we can all use whenever we need to.
Well, how about this? From this pouch, we each take the stater that is there, because there's precisely five, and then the drachma will cover our food and lodgings for today. And the rest remains there for us to use as a group.
That's acceptable.
Simply because this was our first active engagement together, and who knows, we might find individual things we wish to purchase.
Fair enough.
Incense now and then. It's always nice.
Yeah, there's kits, our different arcane foci.
Arathis, so after you have your food and everything, you were going to go and do some star watching?
Yep.
Okay.
Best place is the roof.
Yep. Kyra will join you. She looks up the stars, and you can tell she's knowledgeable enough that she can point out some of the constellations to you. She doesn't know all of them, but she does point out one to you in particular.
Oh.
As she points out, basically there is a one of the constellations, she's like, this is the constellation of the bard, Palernia. She's a famous bard, captured by Lutheria during the First War. Terrified as to her fate, she sang songs of dark humor that made light of the First War's atrocities, which won Lutheria over, and so won her freedom. But as she departed, Palernia grew overbold and tried to steal Lutheria's treasures. She was captured again and taken to the island of the Oathbreakers. There, Lutheria made her an offer. If Palernia could make her laugh with one last song, then all would be forgiven. Before Palernia could take up her lute, Lutheria reached out with the claws and ripped out the bard's tongue, forever silencing her voice. Those five stars remind us of her tale. The two brightest are the singer herself, the next two symbolize her lute, and the small flickering star between them is her severed tongue. She looks, she says, it's a cautionary tale about being haughty in the face of evil. I thought it was something that you may want to keep in mind. And then she helps herself down off the roof.
I thank you for your tale. Safe travels and good slumber.
Is there anything else anybody wishes to do in the evening?
The second salad that Sophia has, she'll like put half of it in her bowl and then just kind of nudge the other bowl over toward the centaur again.
She puts the other half of the bowl down, leans in, uses her nose like Lady and the Tramp to move it over.
No.
Well, once again, anybody paying attention, Agri is totally eating as though this is the first meal in years.
He's a bottomless horse bit.
You got it.
Every meal is the first meal.
He's got four hollow legs to fill up.
Yep.
God, he's probably cursed.
Helena just watches this interaction with interest.
Halfway through, like, you know, eating the meal, he just kind of, like, stops and then sees everybody else kind of paying attention.
Deacon's going to bed early because, well, healing has.
Okay.
If you're still not feeling well in the morning, if you're still aching, let me know.
I will. Thank you.
So morning comes. It is a pleasant day. Still no real sign of rain. But there are scattered clouds here and there. Kyra is already up and about and is basically downstairs polishing off a fairly hearty looking breakfast.
Should I press the long rest icon on my character sheet?
Yes. The long rest icon will reset everything.
I feel much better in the morning.
All right. And actually, since it is the next day... So, after dealing with the boar and getting a night's rest, you guys will level up to level 2.
Yay.
Gasp.
Yeah.
This is the highest level character I've ever played.
Butter boots. Well, now, how do we go about doing this?
Okay, so I will basically, it's easier for me to do it on my end.
Yeah, because it's kind of locked on our...
Because it is kind of locked on yours. So some stuff will be fairly simple, but some people will have some choices to make.
Cool.
Classic. So as a druid at second level is when you choose what circle you want to dedicate yourself to.
Okay.
Did you want to go with Circle of Sacrifice?
Possibly actually multi-classing, Chris.
Okay.
I'm just checking it right now if I can do it at level 2, if I gotta wait till 3. One sec.
Multi-classing you can do whenever you level up.
Okay, barbarian.
Okay, so level of barbarian. Interesting. Barbarian druid.
Yep.
Alright, so yeah, for barbarian you need to have a minimum strength of 13, which you do. That's an interesting choice, but I like it.
Actually, kind of makes sense.
I think so too.
Yeah. Place of the background quite heavily.
I mean, we've seen him eat.
He eats like a horse.
Right. So, as a first level barbarian, that will give you your rage and your unarmored defense.
Perfect.
So your unarmored defense isn't much of a bonus to you because you don't have a high con. But it does give you your rage, of which you get 2. So I will have to code that in at some point because I don't think it's automatic.
Okay.
And it pushes your hook points up significantly.
Darn those hoof points.
His what?
His hoof points.
Points.
Okay.
Health. Hoof.
Oh. Gotcha.
Oh, the jokes. They're getting bad.
All right.
You can tell the bard isn't making these jokes.
Deacon, do you want to do anything weird, or are you still a fighter?
My jokes are funny.
Oh, I'm still a fighter.
My jokes are funny as well. It's just they're less so after a long day.
So you can roll a d10 for your extra hit points.
Okie dokie. So what's the slash rolling for that?
Slash r space 1d10. I let people roll their hit points, and then if they roll less than the average, they can take the average. Boom. So 9 plus 2 for your con, 11 hit points. Wow. Pretty much doubled your hit points. The big thing you get at second level as a fighter is action surge, which doesn't take an action, but it allows you to attack a second time.
Oh, sweet.
You get one use, recharges on a short rest, and then as you get levels in fighter, when you get multiple attacks when you attack, action surge is like a multiplier, so it's not one more attack, it's however many attacks done again.
I will be a whirlwind of doom.
Arathias.
I think this game likes me better than Torg does, though, for rolling.
It seems to. Yeah, you only had 1-1. That's unusual.
Doesn't every game like you better than Torque does?
It does seem that way sometimes, yes.
It could just also be Torque under Chris.
Oh, maybe.
Possibly, but the dice seem allergic to higher numbers, that's for sure. Although sometimes I do hit it out of the park.
As a second level warlock, you get to choose your invocations.
Oh, well, I have two options that I was weighing. At this time, I shall take Agonizing Blast.
Makes sense.
The other one I was considering was Armor of Shadows, but I have potentially people to take that hit for me.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I may not have imported Agonizing Blast yet, so I will have to do that for next time. So, for the time being, I'm just going to edit your spell. And that should add the damage to your Eldritch Blast. And you can roll a d8 for your hit points.
Slightly better than average.
Slightly better than average is still good. Ah, so 6, 7, 16 hit points. 16 hit points. Perfect. Da-da-da-da-da. Helena, staying with Bard.
Oh, I actually get 2 at second level. Never mind.
Yeah, you get.
Yes, yes, I am.
You get 2 invocations, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll definitely Armor Shadows from other one.
Okay.
Yeah, I am staying with Bard.
Perfect.
We're not all are not all Agrius and going to just be 20 levels of 20 different classes.
No, I totally plan on doing the epic poetry bardum, so.
Yeah. So at the second level bard, you do learn a new spell.
Cool.
And you also pick up your jack of all trades.
Great. Jack of all trades is awesome.
Sounds cool.
Jack of all trades is you add half of your proficiency bonus to anything you're not proficient in.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Basically, I'm kind of a little good at everything.
Yeah. The big thing is Jack of all trades applies to counterspell, and it applies to initiative.
Oh, really? I didn't know it applied to my initiative.
It does, because initiative is an ability check.
Cool.
So
that is awesome.
So you can figure out what other spell you would like to choose.
Hold on a sec, my spell cards are over there.
Yeah. And finally, Sophia.
Chris, what level is that? What level spell? Just level one?
Just level one.
Cool. I don't get any more cantrips this level, right?
No.
Just checking.
Okay. And so for Sophia, you can roll a d8 for your hit points, and you have picked up your channel divinity. Oh, it's a good roll. That's another 9 hit points for you.
Pretty good.
And another 7 hit points for you. Perfect. So your channel divinity, which you get at second level, all clerics can do turn undead, and then you also get one that's based upon your deity. You get it once between rests.
And sorry, I'm finding this where?
Under features. You now have your channel divinity.
Huh.
So you can use it to either turn undead, or as an action, you can choose a skill or a tool, and then for 10 minutes you have proficiency with that chosen skill or tool.
That's cool.
As your goddess grants you the knowledge that is necessary.
Yes. And sorry, you said something about a spell?
You don't get any new spells, no. Okay. You can prepare one more because it's your cleric level plus your wisdom, so you can now prepare 4 spells instead of 3.
Okay. And how do I select them in the list here?
To select the ones that you want to prepare?
Yes.
Okay. So if you right click on it, the option will come up to prepare spell.
Okay, how do I get rid of one that is currently sitting at prepared?
You right click on it and choose unprepared.
It doesn't let me select unprepared.
It's because command and identify are your domain spells, and they are always prepared and do not count against the 4 you're allowed to have.
Oh! All right then.
The blessing of your goddess allows you to have those spells prepared. And Armor of Shadows. Gotcha. Let me see here. I should be able to give you a at-will mage armor there, B. Give me one sec.
Yep. I'm just trying to figure out what I'm going to take as my next spell known.
I am taking Dissonant Whispers. Okay. All the psychic damage.
As I look at the path of the character, I'm like, Fighters get spells? Weird.
Alright. There you go. Mage armor should be on your spellbook there.
Yeah, I'll take... I'm also going to take, for my known spell, Protection from Evil and Good.
Protection from Evil and Good. Alright. Should have just kept my spell thing open.
Sorry, I did mention.
Yeah.
Oh man, it's so nice to have an extra +2 armor possible.
And Helena was taking Dissonant Whispers?
Yes.
That's a pretty good spell.
It is a pretty good spell. Chris, how do I roll my hit die for my next...
Okay.
Like, how do I roll just the one dice?
In the Foundry chat, just slash R space 1d8.
Yep, there we go. Slash R D8. Yeah, I need to space it. There we go. There we go. Thank you.
I do find it funny that everybody with the D8 all rolled the same.
It's because I've called upon the fates this game.
Apparently so.
To give us less health?
No, more, because if you roll below 5 is all you get.
Yeah. As we're getting ready for breakfast and people are kind of gathering themselves together, I'll walk up to the human. How's your armor? You seem to be walking a lot better today.
Yeah, the night's rest was good. I feel much better.
Sleeping in bed.
Hey, a bed is always good. The ability to strip my armor off and sleep a great night's sleep is always welcome in a soldier's world.
Your armor's all right, or does it need to be repaired?
No, it's so far so good. I know I got hit hard, but so far, I mean, that the metal survives.
Excellent.
A rough translation. I haven't been told my armor's been rent.
No, your armor is fine. You took a pretty big blow, but it's chained, so it had some give to it.
Not traditionally that kind of game without being told outright.
Yeah, it's nice. It's good. Chains resilient.
Helena sounds like she's humming a new tune, but it still sounds very sad. Almost kind of creepy, actually. Like, haunting.
A lot of minor keys.
Yeah.
Gothling.
I was in my younger days.
And Egri comes down without the leather armor on, just in common clothes.
Who wants to see him in a Hawaiian shirt? Come on.
A Hawaiian shirt on a centaur would be hilarious.
Yes. Yes, it would.
With a nice lei, too. Awesome.
Alright, so you guys gather for breakfast. Judging from the number of plates and empty goblets already on the table, Kyra has been up for a couple of hours at the very least and has put away a decent amount of food and wine.
Wow.
It was only like 2 pitchers over a couple hours. So, We're gonna go see the Oracle today.
Well, I assume we would all like to have breakfast first.
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. I mean...
How much wine have you had, love?
It's fine. It's, you know, two pitchers, but it was two pitchers over several hours.
Uh-huh.
And you guys would all be aware that the wine is always watered down.
Yeah.
The wine is drunk for flavor, not for its alcohol content.
Oh, I think this morning I'll try the barley porridge with the sun-dried grapes. That sounds most intriguing.
I am going to have cheese and fruit.
I'm so happy that you guys are using the menu that I put together.
How can I resist?
It just means like I'm going to have to like be ahead of things at whatever town you may go to, so I have a bunch of menus prepared.
Damn straight. I'm going to have the taconites and honey. So nice little pancakes and honey. Mm. And I'll order the barley porridge with sun-dried grapes as well. I think that does sound good, even though the player despises raisins like you would not believe.
They're not raisins.
They're not raisins. They're sun-dried grapes, yeah.
Right. I'll keep repeating
that. Halfway from grape to raisin.
Halfway.
I'm going to be like splitting the pancakes and honey with the centaur again.
Agri recognizes this and just orders himself spring water.
Are you sure that's all you want? As I'm reaching into to pull drachma out of the pouch.
Yes, I'm good.
Definitely water. This time you notice the bard taking notes.
So, Kyra is, she's like rearranging her pack. You can tell like she's kind of eager to get on the road. But you do manage to take a look, and she's got a bunch of parchment for writing her stories and her poems and everything on. But she also has a fair number of scrolls that you can tell already have writing on them that are just like tucked up, but they're not like in scroll cases or anything of that nature.
As another bard, do I recognize this as like note-taking, that kind of thing?
You would guess that those are probably the stories of other heroes, maybe the ones that went for the boar and didn't make it back.
Okay.
You know, so basically, and there's a fair bit. There's probably like half a dozen or so, which indicates that there's been, you know, probably half a dozen or so groups before you that, you know, did not survive the boar. But she does, like, she keeps those scrolls, so you know that she still intends to tell their story or to work their story into things.
Yeah. When Helena notices this, she won't really say anything, but the little bit of a smirk that was starting to develop over the centaur and the minotaur has just instantly disappears again.
So you guys have your breakfast. Is there anything else that you wanted to do before you set out?
I just wanted to have a little quick look through a little history book that I've gotten to see if this spear kind of somehow figures into something.
Gotcha. Looking through it, the spear doesn't really show up anywhere. And as you look at it, kind of like in the... like the cold light of day sort of thing, you realize that it's literally just a spear that somebody has made ornamental with silver. But you can give me an intelligence check.
Here, I was hoping for a history check.
No, history wouldn't really apply to this. Yeah, 12. Alright, so yeah, you remember tales and stuff like with some of the other soldiers. There are certain creatures that are more susceptible to specific elements. With silver being a fairly common thing, there are, you can't remember what creatures or anything, but you do remember one of the men in your unit telling you about something that he fought, that he ended up killing with a drachma that he basically shoved into its throat, sort of thing. And you're kind of like, yeah, choked a creature to death, but you know, another story here, another story there. So you do know that there are some things that are more susceptible to silver or to gold or to certain types of wood or things of that nature. How much faith you put in that, you don't know, but you've heard those tales.
All right, so basically it sounds like one of these past people, they probably thought this was a creature that could somehow be affected by silver, and then that's why they equipped it. Is it possible for me to kind of remove the head? So that way, if I need to have a silver head on the spear, I can?
Yeah, absolutely you can.
Sounds good. That's what I will be doing during breakfast.
Perfect. So yeah, that way you don't have to carry like the whole spear with you. You can just carry the spear tip, and then if you've got it if you need it.
Bingo!
Yeah. Alright.
Here, I thought you'd just want more spear.
All spear all the time, baby.
Alright. So you guys finish off your breakfast. Again, the food is fairly basic but very well prepared. There's a lot of attention to the little details put in. The hostess, as she's clearing up, she's like, "I knew there was something special about you when you came in. This bodes well. I think this is," and she kind of smiles like that at Kyra and says, I think you finally found what you were looking for." And Kyra kind of smiles back at her and says, still a ways to go." But she ushers you off. She will pack up like a little bit of a lunch for you to bring on the road. Kind of I mean, as far as she's concerned, you guys are heroes. And as she's packing up the lunch and everything, Cairo will kind of lean over and says, like, as people start to hear of you and hear of your deeds, you know, this sort of thing will become more common."
Oh.
It's the people like their tales. But what they like more than tales is a hero that they can touch or interact with or do something for.
It's not unknown in my profession.
I will.
Yes.
Thank the barmaid for the lunch she's packed up for us, and like give her like a little signed poem.
She will fold it up and kind of tuck it into her apron for safekeeping.
Okay.
So as you said, on the road, Kyra will look to you and say, "I realize that all of you have a place in the tapestry, a destiny, a fate," and she looks at Arathius when she says that. "I can't pretend to know what the road ahead will entail, but Versi will be able to give you guidance. She's guided kings and gods and set them on the right path towards what they were meant to be. But I do feel I need to warn you that not everybody is destined to greatness, and not everybody is destined to come out alive at the end."
Well, not every poem is
fate.
not every poem is a hero's tale. Some are tragedies.
Exactly.
Some of us are aware of that.
So, but if you have any questions for her, she should be able to answer them. Or at least set your feet upon the proper path. And as you make your way off towards the Temple of the Oracle, we'll call it there, because it's like 5 to 11.
Yes.
Sweet.
Sweet deal.
Interesting.
That's terrible.
But yes, you guys are through the prologue.
Woohoo!
Personally, I find this really quite interesting. I'm actually quite happy with how D&D is working out.
I'm trying to make it entertaining, and the fact is this campaign, the guys that put it together are like big creative people from BioWare. So like, I'm a big fan of KOTOR and Baldur's Gate and Dragon's Age, and it's very much the same sort of writing where it's like, Big things are happening, but there's a lot of places where you guys are going to make interesting choices.
Yeah, I can't count the number of hours I remember playing on Baldur's Gate. God.
Yes.
I am loving how good the thematics are. Like, it really has that ancient Greek feel to it.
I have started upon my epic.
Excellent. And that's the other thing. Those epic destinies that you guys chose, they're not something that's going to start showing up when you're like 10th, 12th, 13th, 14th level. Like, some of you are already on the path.
That's what I was...
Some of us have already been warned.
Some of you have been warned.
I can't even remember what I took. What did I take?
That's why I was keen to check out that sphere. You never know.
Yes. Yeah. That's true. Magic weapons
are
magic weapons.
All right. But yes, we will see everybody in 2 weeks' time to continue this as you guys are off to meet the Oracle, the wonderful Oracle of not Delphi.
Or Oz.
Oh, cursed. I took the curse.
Yeah.
That's total. Just don't look behind the curtain.